listening to the Republic Broadcasting Network. Because you can handle the truth. Monday through Friday, 10 p.m. to 12 a.m. Eastern. You can listen to this broadcast on TalkStreamLive.com, RepublicBroadcasting.org, a sprinkling of radio stations coast to coast, and also on my homepage, OutcastRadio.net. Listen live online is the icon, and you can also call in toll-free at 800-313-9443. Send me an email at OCDAustin@Yahoo.com, Facebook, OutcastRadio.net. Send a tweet to OCD Austin. Here are the headlines making news at OutcastRadio.net. Saturn's moon Titan invaded from massive oil reserves. Solar CME strikes Earth, 6.9 earthquake CERN, pushing flat Earth to another level. L.A. Marzulli, Nephilim artifact. Steve Quayle, are we witnessing the end times and exploring a real World War III elite bunker? All at OutcastRadio.net. While we're on the subject of Flat Earth, probably one of the hottest Flat Earth channels as far as YouTube is concerned is one called Mark Sargent. That's M-A-R-K-K-S-A-R-G-E-N-T. And I believe the man may be from Washington State, at least by looking at his website. Good evening, Mark. How are you doing?
Well, thank you very much for having me, by the way.
Thank you for tracking me down and me tracking you down. When did you have your epiphany? Was it subtle, suddenly, or did it gradually come over a period of time?
It gradually came over a period of time. I looked at it back in the summer of 2014, and like most flat earthers, you know, there's a T-shirt that's going to be made, and that is, I tried to debunk it, and I failed. It took me months. To get through it. I initially thought, well, this is crazy. Everyone's heard of it, of course. You know, we've heard of it since we're kids, you know, one form or another. I initially looked at some flights that didn't make any sense. There was a YouTube guy from Germany that was talking about flights in the Southern Hemisphere that didn't make sense. And then I had watched the Matt Boylan video where he said that when he was in his 20s, he worked for NASA and he was painting for them, and they had disclosed to him at some point that the world really wasn't a sphere at all, that it was really just kind of a flat disc shape. And he didn't buy it. And I didn't buy it either. I tried to disprove it for a long time, but the more I dug into it, the more the world that I was living in started to unravel. To when I got to February of 2015, it just clicked. I just got up in the middle of the night. I had that Jerry Maguire moment. And I said, you know what? I'm going to go the other way with this, and I'm going to put something out on the internet, and I'm going to say, all right, look, I think that the flat earth theory, which we gave up 500 years ago, was all wrong, was right all along, and that science, when they came along with the spheres theory 500 years ago, they made a huge mistake. They made an assumption that just wasn't there. And that was, 14 months ago now, and I said, prove me wrong. Show me how I'm wrong. And not only has no one come forward, at least from a professional sector or a military sector, or especially NASA, to shut this thing down, it's just grown and grown. And now I'm interviewing people from different parts of the world who are coming to me and saying, look, you know, all our instruments say that it is flat. And that's where I am now. I mean, today I had an interview this morning, and I think today this is the one I'm on with you. It's my 76th interview I've done since I started this in only 14 months.
When you gave the analogy of as gradual, I kind of look at it as a tea bag slowly being dipped in warm water. It was only a month ago. I say this on the show a lot, that I'm bi. I can go flat earth or I can go round earth. But about a month ago, I went 51-49 flat. And now I'm 60-40 flat. And it seems that every day the mountain of evidence that proves the earth is flat continues to grow, whereas those who defend the round theory, the heliocentric theory, seems to diminish. Are you noticing that more people are dialing into the flat earth theory and it's becoming an exponential?
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's resonating in a way that I would have lost money on this if I would have tried to figure out the odds. When I put out the Flat Earth Clues, the series that I created back in the beginning of 2015, February 10th, if you want to be exact, if you did a search on YouTube, you just went into YouTube, no filters, and typed in Flat Earth, you maybe got, I don't know, maybe 50,000 hits, you know, relevant hits, relevant subject hits. But if you did the same thing this morning, you're pushing about 6 million. And it's a 10,000% increase in a very, very short amount of time. And not only that, though, the demographics are all over the place. It doesn't really matter, what age you are, what your background is, unless you have like a master's degree or higher in a physical science, you're not going to ignore it entirely. And what also kind of struck me was that it is one of the few conspiracies, in fact, the only one that I know that's really resonated with women. The conspiracy world is notoriously male heavy. And I think maybe 30% of the emails and phone calls I get are from women, which is amazing. Call it women's intuition, but it's ringing true with them. And so it's been a really exciting time.
No one has ever brought that up, and as you were saying that, this thought occurred to me. Are you a Christian?
I am.
Okay. Women are more sensitive to the Holy Spirit. You talked about intuition, and I think instinctively, from a spiritual point of view, a woman who is a Christian probably is more receptive to the things of God. Maybe this is part of what's going on. I believe underneath all of this, Mark, it is a spiritual war between evolutionary theory versus creationism.
I would agree with you wholeheartedly. This particular concept, and I touched on this when I was getting deeper into the clues, really boiled down to spirituality and not necessarily say that it's a war against science, but it's calling out science for what it is. And that is, they will hide spirituality whenever possible. And if that means evolution, if that means the Big Bang, or in this case, hiding the very world that you live on. It'd be extremely difficult to be an atheist and believe in the enclosed system, the firmament, everything that we hear about in the Bible. Let me take it a different way. If science found out, we all know that we protect our own interests. That's what we do. We have these survival instincts, and science is no different. They have made huge mistakes in the past, and maybe we can go over some of those later. But with this, if they were the first ones to find that there was a handprint of God out there, there was actually proof of intelligent design, would they hide it? Absolutely, they would hide it. The analogy I use more and more often now is the Raiders of the Lost Ark theory. If anyone remembers that movie from 1981 where they're looking for the Ark of the Covenant. The Americans get it at the very end. And what happens in the very last scene of that movie? What do they do with the Ark? They put it in a crate, they put it in a warehouse, and no one ever gets to see it. And that is because science does not even want to begin to answer questions of spirituality, including artifacts. Every religion has been looking for an artifact or a relic that will solidify their faith. Whether it's the Holy Grail, the Ark of the Covenant, the Spear of Destiny, whatever it is. If our world is actually constructed, if there's proof of construction, if there is proof of a structure, then that means there's a creator, And that means that we were created, and then science has to take, it has to retool just about everything they've got going right now.
You know, I was having this thought while you were saying that. It seems that those that are the most vicious in their attack against the flat earth are those that are true Darwinists, those that are true atheists. Isn't it interesting, curious at best, that those that don't believe in God are the most ardent in their belief of a round theory?
It kind of struck me as strange that what I've been trying to tell people recently is the only way you are immune from finding out the truth of this thing is if you don't look at it. If you know the story of Pandora's box, and that is, if you don't open the box, you're fine, because you can deny it all you want. You can just say, "Oh, that box is stupid. I'm never opening that box." You look in that box, you're a moron. I hear that a lot, you know. But replace Pandora's box with flat Earth. Once you look at it for a few minutes, you're going to get it. But yeah, the people that don't look at it, they're the ones that are saying they absolutely buy into evolution. They will, you know, beat the Big Bang drum all day long, and they won't. It's like, look, how hard is it to understand? Do you really think all this is an accident? Everything, the wonder and splendor of this world you're living in, this is an accident? This is just a happenstance? Don't think of that, you know, not for a second. Science has told you that because they're building their own religion. And, you know, the flat earth takes it back.
Let's get into the nuts and bolts of it. Why is it that man is not allowed to fly over the South Pole?
It's a good one. Couple reasons. Well, it depends who you talk to. Because they'll initially say that, well, there was this accident with an airline back in the 70s, and they crashed into this mountain, and it's not very safe. But there is no reason. They don't give a reason. They just don't fly over it. So what I mean is, if you believe in the globe model, there are shortcuts you can take. And this is what really kind of got me into the flat earth. There are shortcuts you can take to get from one place to another. One of this is, you know, to fly over Antarctica to get from somewhere in the southern hemisphere to somewhere else in the southern hemisphere. That doesn't happen. They don't tell you why. In fact, I interviewed an international traveler, a corporate travel agent, and she said that she gets complaints all the time in the southern hemisphere. I'll give you a perfect example of something that more people can relate to. If you're flying anywhere from South America to anywhere in Australia, you should just be going across the southern hemisphere, right? It's the southern half of the globe. There's no reason for you to go north for any of these flights. But if you try to book somewhere, like let's say from like Rio to Sydney, it's amazing what you'll see when you start looking in the travel logs. You'll see out of maybe 50 flights for that day, 49 of them will have multiple connections, and they're all going all over the place, way, way out of their way to the north. And every pilot that I've talked to, they say, look, when it comes to flying, the only thing anyone cares about is, you know, pounds of fuel, money, how much fuel you're burning. If you think for a second they're going to fly to the Middle East, or go to North America just to, you know, pick up a few people. No. You always stay in the southern hemisphere. But they don't. There's almost no direct flights from anywhere in South America to anywhere in Australia. It's almost non-existent. And when you do go, the routes don't make sense. And by that I mean the flight routes don't. You can't prove them, meaning the GPS system, and I know we're kind of bouncing around a little bit, the GPS system designed by the United States military in the mid-90s by the DOD, which came online in the mid-90s, which it supposedly had 36 satellites that are supposedly spinning around the Earth at all time and should have blanket coverage over the globe. They don't track anything over the oceans, and not just the southern hemisphere, but the northern hemisphere as well. So when you are flying your plane and you get about 150, 200 miles offshore, your latitude and longitude disappear. Your family, if they're looking for you, they will not be able to find you. You are not on the map anymore. And you stay off the map until you get, coincidentally, within 150, 200 miles of your destination, and then you pop back on and then you land. And no one has really paid attention to this because technically when you're looking on a grid, if you're looking at planefinder.net or Flight Tracker 24, your plane still shows up. It still looks like it's flying across the ocean. But if you click on it and try to get the details, there are no details. It's just a graphic. So the route cannot be proven. And the reason they do that is because they're trying to hide the route from you. And the reason they're trying to hide the route from you is because the shape is wrong. The maps are completely wrong. The only map that matters right now, the only one I've been preaching for the last 12 months, is the azimuthal equidistant map, otherwise known as the UN flag.
Back in 2005, I took a trip to Anchorage, Alaska, and I was asking about nonstop flights to London. How do they work? And they said, "Well, if you take off from Anchorage, you go
that you don't have to build it very high because why would anyone go there?" And then, of course, the questions come up, you know, eventually. It's like, well, what about the space program? Wouldn't they be able to figure this out? It's like, well, that's the crux, isn't it? Those would be the gatekeepers. And I go on and they say, because people eventually say, well, don't you believe in the space program? I go, no. Not only do I believe the space program was completely fabricated day one, I'm saying the only reason they were built, the only reason NASA even started up was they discovered the edge of this thing back in the late 50s. And they had to figure out a way to control the sky. And that's what they did. You know, they, again, look up high altitude nuclear testing, which is, or high altitude nuclear explosions, that were started by the Russians, I'm sorry, the Soviet Union and the United States back in 1958. They fired rockets straight up for 4 years, tipped with atomic weapons. And after the first three shots, NASA is formed. And then NASA starts up, and there's the so-called space race, and then 1959, Van Allen radiation belts are announced by NASA, a NASA employee, Van Allen, and in the very same year, Antarctica was locked down very quietly for all time. If it was just one of those two things, I would say, yeah, it might be a coincidence, but when you seal off the outer edge and the upper edge in the same year, that just screams structure. You know, and not only that, but you're locking down the outer edge from, you know, and saying that money, there's something that's bigger than money. Doesn't matter how much money you spend. Let me throw one more thing at you. Not only can you not go out to Antarctica with your company, you can't even lobby any political parties to go down there. So, like, you'd think, like, say you're the head of Exxon. You know, you got a buddy at the New York Times. You could run a story every week and say why it's good for America to go down to Antarctica. You're not even allowed to do that. What story is bigger than money? I'll tell you what, it's the very world we live in.
You know, I was thinking about Qantas Airlines. They actually have flights to the South Pole, but not really. I was checking this video out a couple of weeks ago where they do fly from Sydney down to Antarctica, but what they do is they go in just a few miles and then they kind of skirt the coast. And I think what people need to get in their mind is this idea that it is a frisbee surrounded by an ice wall, dome shape, and probably diamond shaped underneath. Is that what you believe is underneath the Earth? Is it more of a diamond shape underneath the Earth?
Well, it could be. It's really hard to say, though, because unfortunately, and again, this is one of those things I'll throw at science if I ever get a scientist to debate me. Which is, let me do it a different way. We've all seen in the textbooks the cross-section of our world, right? They show, if you believe in the globe, then it's 4,000 miles to the center and 8,000 miles all the way across. And we've all seen the textbook pictures where you got a red band up at the top followed by an orange band and a yellow and a white milky, you know, molten center. And it's like, wow, that's really great. So you sent down probes that far, right? You know, 4,000 miles. No? 2,000 then. 1,000? 100? 10? We haven't even drilled down 10 miles. Not even, barely a fraction of a percentage. We've drilled back, the deepest hole we've ever drilled is 8 miles. And after that, the drill bits stop working. We can't get past 8 miles, at least from a civilian standpoint. So why are you telling me what the cross-section of the Earth is? And that's because science also, you know, they make leaps of faith, or really what they do is they don't like unanswered questions, so they just put that out there. And they say, well, we know. Like, well, how do you know? Well, you know, we have seismic radar, and, you know, we looked at volcanic formations. We know. And I'm going, well, but you haven't been down there. So when people ask me, they say, well, how deep is this, and what's the shape of it underneath? It's like, well, deep, as far as deepness goes, I mean, the magma system, that's definitely down around 8 miles. We know that. What's below that? Hard to say. It could be just about any shape you want. Could it be a diamond shape underneath? Sure. You're absolutely right. It could be. Or could it be, another half circle underneath, with another world on the other side of that? It's hard to say. All I can tell you is that it's not what they're telling you. It is, the globe, everything. When people say that, the first thing they'll say is, well, we've seen pictures from space, and I'll come back and I'd say, well, have you really? Because most of that's assumed. The first picture that was ever fully taken of the Earth in sunlight from space was in 1972, which raises several questions. One, if we had rockets that were going up there since 1957, and not only that, but Apollo 9, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, that supposedly went to the moon and back, why didn't they take any pictures? Why did they wait literally until the last mission on the way home? And it's like, oh, yeah, since this is the last mission back from the moon, maybe we should take a picture of the Earth. And then after 1972, they don't take another picture for 43 years. 43 years. That's two generations of people. I mean, all the satellites, all the probes they supposedly sent up, and nobody, the Hubble Space Telescope, Soyuz, the space station, nobody spun around and took a picture until we started talking about it, the whole flat Earth groups. And then all of a sudden, in July of last year, 2015, it's like, oh, yeah, by the way, here's a satellite that we've recasted a million miles near the picture of the Earth. And I come back, I say, no, you're going to do that, you're going to run into the angry wife scenario. I say, what's the angry wife scenario? And that is, husband comes home to his wife after 40 years, and she goes, oh, yeah, by the way, I'm divorcing you. He goes, why? And she goes, well, because in 40 years, you've only given me one bouquet of flowers. So the very next day, what does he do? He comes home with a bouquet of flowers. And he goes, hey, now you don't have to divorce me anymore. And she goes, what are you talking about? The only reason you got me that bouquet is because I said you didn't buy any. That's what happened. And I'm not making this up. The White House tweeted it. NASA, releases it on their website. A big press release. It's like, by the way, a second blue marble shot ever in 43 years. Because they couldn't just release the picture and not tell people where it came from. They were forced to release it. And now they're releasing space stories every day just to keep reinforcing the globe model, because it's all starting to fall apart.
My guest is Mark Sargent. He has a YouTube channel. It's called Mark Sargent, MarkSargent. Mark, if the Earth is round and there is curvature, when you're flying an airplane, wouldn't you have to, in fact, compensate by lowering the nose as you're flying at 37,000 feet?
Yes. Yes, you would. It's an excellent question. I'll give you the math real quick. And it's not hard math. People kind of glaze over when I tell them the math, but it's not hard. That is the curvature of the Earth. If you believe that it's a globe, the curvature of the Earth, and this is not our math, this is mainstream science, stuff in any textbook, is 8 inches per mile squared, which means 8 inches per mile times itself. So if it's 2 miles, it's 2 times itself, which is 4, times 8 inches, which is 32 inches. So at 2 miles, there should be 32 inches of curve. And at 3, it's 3 times 3 is 9, times 8 is 72. And it just gets worse and worse, because eventually, if it's a globe, the hill is just going to get steeper and steeper until it falls off vertical into infinity, and then you're off the globe. So quite a few people noticed right off the bat, it's like, okay, if you're flying in an airplane, you're flying pretty fast. You're flying 500 miles an hour, 600 miles an hour if it's a commercial airliner. You're going to have to account for this pretty quick, because you're talking about, even at 60 miles, you're talking about a couple thousand feet worth of curvature you're going to have to adjust for. So wouldn't the plane have to adjust one way or the other? Meaning, if the argument is, okay, if they stay level, then the curve is going to start sloping down beneath them, and they're going to start gaining altitude, even if they think they're going level. And then people come back and say, no, gravity is going to be pulling them down. Gravity is going to be constantly pulling them down, the nose down. I'll go, oh, okay. Well, then they're going to be constantly trying to pull up.
Hang on just a second, Mark. We got to take our first break. Hold that thought. We're talking about flat Earth versus round and flying in a plane at 600 miles an hour at 37,000 feet. We'll get the full answer coming up next.
You are- are tuned in to the Republic Broadcasting Network. Visit our website by going to republicbroadcasting.org.
Homeowners, are you in foreclosure, expecting to be served with a foreclosure lawsuit, or suspect your lender has coerced you into an illegal mortgage transaction? A huge number of mortgages made in the last 10 years have legal issues and are possibly defective. State laws and the U.S. Supreme Court have upheld that defective mortgage documents are grounds for foreclosure defense and for counterclaims in favor of the homeowner. If your mortgage has been sold or assigned since closing the loan, it may be defective and you may be paying the wrong party, and the lender may not have standing or the right to foreclose or collect payments under the law. If you would like to know if your mortgage is legal or not, or know if you are paying the right party, we can help. Our initial consultations are free of charge. We are not attorneys. We are legal researchers and work closely with experienced lawyers who know how to help you find the evidence to help you keep your home. Call toll free 1-855-2-KEEP-IT. That's 1-855-2-KEEP-IT today.
Are you still looking for that one iodine that you can really trust? A medical doctor-endorsed product that is backed by honest research and true integrative science? Then search no further. Go to NutraMedical.com for Dr. Bill Deagle's Nutriodine, proven time and time again to be the very best iodine available for you. Nutriodine is the only Tesla-activated monatomic plasma iodine in the world. It optimizes mitochondrial function and generation of new mitochondria from totally neutralizing the venom from a desert recluse spider bite in Southern California to eliminating malaria parasites reported by medical missionaries in Central India. Dr. Bill's Nutriodine is simply the most powerful healing formula there is. Nutriodine clears the body of all known pathogens, restores it to an alkaline state, and even promotes stem cell regeneration. Order Dr. Bill's Nutriodine today at 888-212-8871 or visit us online at NutriMedical.com.
Roberts & Roberts Brokerage believes that everyone should have some of their assets in investment-grade precious metals. Roberts & Roberts has been a trusted name in precious metals for nearly 40 years. Experienced investors will appreciate our personal service and low prices. If you're new to precious metals, we can help you find the products right for you. Give us a call today at 800-874-9760 or visit us online at rrbi.co. Roberts & Roberts Brokerage, when you're serious about precious metals.
With autumn in the air, it's time to think about getting ready for winter. And it's time to save at HerbalHealer.com. You'll find amazing seasonal savings to prepare you for the fight against cold and flu season. Like Oregacillin to promote lung health. 30 capsules, regularly $34.95, now only $25. HHA Olive Leaf, the natural antiviral, normally $16.95, now 60 capsules are just $12. HHA Elderberry Power, a great flu and virus fighter, regularly $16.95, 60 capsules, now $10. Save on all our homeopathic detoxes. Choose from lungs, kidney, liver, brain, libido, or whole body, normally $26.95, now just $20. Visit HerbalHealer.com and click on the Fall Winter Specials button to save on all our natural cold and flu fighting products. Also explore our Herbal Healer Academy correspondence courses that teach you how to handle your health naturally. HerbalHealer.com, healing the world with nature, one person at a time, since 1988.
For the most amazing, calming, brain-stabilizing, blood sugar, and natural addiction-breaking formula, try CalMind. Anxiety melts, panic is gone, sleep is restful, and you'll stay calm during stress. Better than booze, mind-altering drugs, or anti-anxiety, antidepressant, toxic medications, CalMind lubricates your mind so you'll sail through the day effortlessly. Order Dr. Bill Deagle's Nutridyne at 888-212-8871 or NutriMedical.com and listen to the NutriMedical Report on GCN with open lines every weekday. NutriMedical, bringing nutrition and medicine together.
This is Outcast Radio, heard worldwide at OutcastRadio.net. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for being a part of the show. As you know, I don't do a lot of interviews. I would say in the last year, you could probably count them on one hand, one of which being Rob Skiba. I am completely fascinated with this subject. It's flat earth. And one of the foremost authorities, in my opinion, is on the show right now. His name is Mark Sargent. His YouTube channel is MarkSargent. I highly recommend you go there to find out more. We're talking about flight. Let's say you're at 37,000 feet going 600 miles per hour. Wouldn't you have to adjust for the curvature of the earth? Now, you explained the mathematics. Explain the practicality of it in real life.
Okay. The gyro that is used on airplanes, what you do is when you're on the ground, you set it, and the gyro is there to set a horizon for you. So that if you get disoriented in any way, as far as, you know, up or down, you can look and say, okay, this is level. Because when you're on the ground, especially at airport runway, you're level. That gyro, that level indicator is not going to change. And what I have noticed, you know, because I've interviewed on the show that I do some really, really great guys, retired United States Air Force navigator, a pilot from the United States Army, and a gentleman out of Iowa who owns his own flight instruction company. And when they were talking, they all corroborate each other's stories, which is, that level indicator does not change. Meaning sooner or later, if it's a globe, you will have to account for the curve. It's no different than flying over a hill. You know, the globe is just much, much bigger. But with the plane, since it's going much, much faster, you're going to have to account for those thousands of feet in curvature. You're going to have to either nose down or nose up, depending on what school of thought you believe in. And they said it just doesn't happen. It never happens. And the people come back and say, wouldn't that mean that every pilot is in on it? You know, that they all know this secret that the earth is actually flat. And they don't because, no pilots know this because it's the last thing on their mind. I touched on this in one of the clues, which is every pilot, when they're up there at a certain level, they see flatness. And people say, no, I've seen a curve out of the airplane. I go, no, you haven't. I put this challenge out to, you want to see it. I put this challenge out to the internet, last year, and I said, you think you see a curvature, and I'll make the challenge even today. You take a picture of it, you hold it up on your computer, and you draw, hold a ruler up to it or a straight edge or whatever it is. Tell me that the curve is still there. And if it is, you email that to me, and I'll put you on the air, and I'll say, holy smoke, this guy just debunked a flat earth. And nobody has to date, including all these pilots. All the pilots say the same thing. It's like, we're up there. It's totally flat when we look. But does that mean the earth is?
It's strange because I was actually studying to be a pilot, and one of the instruments in the cockpit is what they call artificial horizon. It keeps you from crashing in the ground. And one of the most basic questions I have is, okay, if there is curvature, if the earth is round, why isn't the artificial horizon instrument curved? It is flat. When you're flying level, it shows a flatness and not a curvature.
Absolutely right. There have been people that have taken apps on planes because human beings are very sensitive to motion. I will give you that. We're horrible when it comes to visual stuff, but we're really good when it comes to motion, as far as feeling motion. It doesn't mean that it's real motion, but we are feel motion. And there are people that have taken apps on planes, and they've noticed that when they get up, what happens is like a commercial airliner, it goes up to cruising altitude, levels off, and then stays level. We would feel the dips because if you had to adjust a couple thousand feet every 50, 60 miles, you would feel those dips as a passenger. You would have to nose down or nose up to compensate for it. The computers wouldn't be able to do it that smoothly because they would have to adjust. How often do you do it? Every 10 miles, every 20 miles? Eventually you would have to do it, and they never ever do. And the pilots that I have interviewed, they all said the same. I say, how did you miss it? Kind of like the surveys are interviewed. I go, how did you miss this? How do all the pilots not catch this? And they go, because we're so indoctrinated into it when we're growing up, it's the last thing on your checklist. Meaning when, if a pilot, even if a pilot did look up on the horizon, right, and they said, it looks really, really flat, right? But that can't be. That would mean the maps are wrong and all these things are wrong. Even if you were a pilot and you thought it was flat, who are you going to tell? If you're a commercial pilot, you're going to go to your supervisor? You're going to go to the FAA? You're not going to tell anybody. And I joked about that in one of the clues. I said, you'd be better off telling you're higher up, that you were chased by a UFO for 2 hours.
That's like a pilot getting on television and starting to talk about chemtrails. Goodbye career. You know, they know.
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about the difference in climate between the North Pole and the South Pole, and it is absolutely dramatic. In the summertime, I've been in Alaska, like I mentioned earlier, it was 80 degrees every day in Fairbanks, Alaska, at the 63rd parallel latitude. Yeah. Okay, the South Pole, the average temperature at the South Pole is 9 degrees below zero. That is the average temperature for the year. How do they rationalize that? And both you and I know that the reason it's so much colder at the South Pole is because it's on the outer rim of outer space. But explain the rationale and how we get this climate differential between the two.
They don't really explain it. They'll say the Arctic ice is there, and you know it still gets really, really cold. But it's like, well, yeah, but why are you letting planes fly over the Arctic Circle? You know, you can fly over the North Pole all day long. For the most part. I mean, there may be a couple areas which are a little sketchy, but for the most part, you can fly across the North Pole. But in the South Pole, let me define, people, because a lot of people don't really think about Antarctica. Again, it's conditioning. It's not on our mind. You know, Santa Claus lives at the North Pole. Nobody lives at the South Pole. Right? There's no legends or myths that are happening down there. Antarctica as a continent is the most unique thing, even what science describes. Take the flat Earth out of it, is the most unique continent of all time because it's different from anything else. When you get there, you know, on top of icebergs, you know, being horribly frequent along the edge, there's a 200-foot wall of basically solid ice from the water straight up. And if you can get on top of that, you can remember up until we really had helicopters and decent ships, you know, gas-powered ships, we couldn't even do that. But if you can get on top of that 200-foot ice wall, then the ground starts sloping up immediately to about 10,000 feet, and that's about 2 miles. You know, the air starts getting pretty thin. You know, people will get altitude sickness at 8,000 feet. And it's plateaus. Most of the continent is above normal human elevation tolerances. And there are places that goes from 10,000 feet to 20,000 feet. And it's completely barren. I mean, it is the ice is amazingly thick. There is no indigenous plant life. There is no indigenous animal life. There's no remnants of any older civilizations as far as we know, and it goes on for a very, very long time. And by that, I mean the world's, I consider the greatest explorer, at least in terms of what he covered. Admiral Richard E. Byrd, the youngest admiral of the United States Navy, made rear admiral at age 41, he was down there looking for something for the better part of 30 years. And he wasn't looking with sled dogs, he was looking with planes. That's how big this place is. And he was flying around. I mean, if you can't find something, you know, flying in a plane, you're flying your own plane for 30 years with refueling station, you're talking about a really big area, probably way, way bigger than what the maps explain, to where it sounded like he even gave up in 1954. So from 1928 all the way until 1954, he was flying and flying and flying. 1954, he goes on television, and he says, yeah, this whole place is pretty much made out of money. There's enough coal for the entire world for a long time. There's oil, there's uranium, there's minerals. All these countries are down there. You know, they're doing business. Everyone's getting ready for the big resource gathering thing of all time. You know, you've got Russia, Great Britain, Argentina, New Zealand, Australia, Chile. Everybody's down there that can be down there. And then he goes down for one last mission in 1955 to 1956 called Operation Deep Freeze. And while he's down there, something happens. And for me, I knew exactly what it was. He found what he was always looking for, which was some sort of fragment, some sort of part of the edge of the world. And I'm not talking about an edge you fall off of. I'm talking about a wall, a barrier, something that keeps us in. And at that point, all these countries that supposedly were so interested in resources, they all left instantly, like their lives depended on it. They all said, nope. If nobody, we're leaving, and nobody ever gets to go down here ever again. Not going to tell you why. We're just going to, everyone goes and leaves. And this was in 1959. People say, well, it's environmental. It's like, not in 1959. I mean, Greenpeace wasn't even founded until 1971. So what was it? It was like, well, whatever it is, it's so big, it's beyond money. And for me, there's only one thing it can be, and that is the edge. It is proof of where we live, and it's probably
well,
the most awesome
you
thing.
You brought up something that I hadn't considered, and I'm somewhat of a newbie on this. The idea that the flat Earth at the edge is more like a saucer, the kind of saucer you would put your cup in, and it curves up, and that would explain how the water is held in. Is that what we're looking at? Okay.
Oh yeah, absolutely it is. It in fact, yeah, that's one of the first, because we all know this as kids, and that is, why wouldn't ships fall off the edge, and what holds the water in there? Yeah, that statement bugs the crap out of me. Because when you get out, when you see Antarctica, even just the basic shape of Antarctica, if it did wrap around us, that's what it would. I mean, a 200-foot wall of ice that, even the roughest storms couldn't get to the top of that, and then it just keeps slowly, sloping up and up and up, to like a saucer, what you were saying. Yeah, no water's getting out of there. I mean, technically, you could have a flood of biblical proportion. And Antarctica would, and it would still hold in all the water.
So is it literally like the Truman Show? Do you reach a point like Admiral Byrd may have reached where it sloped up to a point where it reaches the firmament, where literally that dome is meeting the earth? I mean, what is that like? I mean, do you literally knock your head into a dome? I mean, that's just mind-blowing to even ask the question.
It depends how you build it. You could build it as a hard barrier, but it depends what you use as a material. If you want to go down the science fiction road, it could be electromagnetic, it could be frequency-based. There's been some people over the last couple of weeks have actually been touching on the fact that it could be some form of heavy water to where, you wouldn't exactly clunk your head into it. You would go into it, you wouldn't be able to go very far. Sort of like a soft barrier. It's very possible. I'm really intrigued by the whole water thing that has been coming up over
Well,
the last
let me throw a wrench at you. Are you familiar with a guy named Anthony Patch?
Maybe not by name.
Okay, this guy is all about CERN, the Large Hadron Collider. His contention is that gravity is not the overriding force in the universe. In fact, it's an electric universe, and that kind of tags into string theory that literally everything we've been told, not just the Earth being round, but what we're comprised of is a lie, that it's more vibrations and that God has created this reality for us that is really comprised of vibrations. Are you getting to the point with Flat Earth where you're beginning to question everything about reality? Because I know I am.
Yeah, I am, because, if you would have brought up Flat Earth a couple hundred years ago, we describe it in the tools that we're limited in. So if you brought it a couple of years ago, they would have said, God's a mechanical engineer or a stonemason. But being in the technology sector as long as I've been, I would go as far as to say that God was a programmer. Because, and not to say that this isn't real, but and then we're kind of splitting hairs on defining what's reality. I mean, if we are made up of atoms, it's a proton electron thing, and it is an electric universe, then, then everything around us is tied to that. I do believe that, we are a physical, we are a physical manifestation, but only from our standpoint. Meaning God is so far above that, he's building us in blocks that we can't understand yet. I kind of joke about the holodeck on Star Trek Next Generation, where you can create matter. It's an invention that was way above even that technology that they were using. I think that if we ever invent that, we would come even closer to defining what we are. So right now, we're just defining it with the tools that are available to us.
How much of this do you think ties into the singularity and the transhumanist movement? Is this all part of the evolutionary lie that's going to lead to the great deception, in part?
Well, I believe that people have said, because I've gotten a bunch of emails over the last year as far as, is this part of the great deception? I was going, well, hiding the very world we live in, to such a degree that 99.99%, the saying of that is it fools even the elect. This would be a very, very much a likely candidate to that. If there's something bigger than that, maybe. But for now, this is the thing that's in my path at the moment. But yes, I do think it's part of the grand deception. I am hoping, because I try to think of a world you know, with the glass half full, which is, I like to think it might be the potential of a new golden age if it's handled right, that we have the chance to become better. But if you follow history, you know, the powers that be, you know, have a tendency to turn things down a darker path. And it could also go that way as well. You know, if you wanted to, I don't want to scare people necessarily, but if you wanted to create, if you want a catalyst for a new world order, something that would really kick things into a whole other gear, boy, this would be it. This would be the one thing, because it's a side effect of it. It's a default side effect. You don't even have to tell people. You know, it's like you don't even have to introduce the new world order. All you have to do is say, oh, yeah, by the way, the world is, you're living in, it's flat. Always was flat. We made a mistake 500 years ago. Sorry about that. As soon as you hear that, everyone all of a sudden is in the same boat.
Well, let me add another layer to this insanity. I mean, this insanity that you're stating, because I'm going to make it even crazier. And I just thought of this. If the world, the Illuminati, the Satanists, the Luciferians, make an announcement that the world is flat, maybe simultaneously that would be part of the Great Deception, and our alien savior is here to help us. It's all part of panspermia. And ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome your overlords? And this goes back to the sci-fi show Childhood's End by Arthur C. Clarke.
I've watched that.
Dude, I'm telling you, this is where I think it's going. And you just added a layer I didn't even consider. Think about this. If, you know, here we are as Christians trying to tell people that we think the earth is flat, and they think we're nuts, and I don't care, and I know you don't either. But no, imagine if the elite were to reveal the great lie is that the earth is flat, and now to prove it, here is your alien savior who's going to recommend you become like him and accept this mark so you'll no longer be human and eligible for salvation.
Don't think. I believe in predictive programming, and childhood ends. Just came out. It was, you know, it just ran its course not very, very long ago at all. And you're absolutely right. That's how they would play it, because there's so many different ways they could go with it. One would be, not even necessarily have to say an alien savior. You say, by the way, the earth is flat, and here are the builders. Welcome to our show. You know, this cool-looking alien. It probably wouldn't be red and scaly. But, you know, all you have to do is park a big spaceship in front of it, and
I don't usually use this word on the radio, but, dude, you're on it. I think this is exactly how it's going to go down, and I never even thought of it until a minute ago when you brought it up.
It's a fascinating concept, and I thought of this in some of my quieter moments. I was going, you know, because it's – Here's the other thing, because other people, if you're smart enough to go this far, you're also smart enough to realize it's like, okay, we could have been talking about this years ago, a long time ago. Why are we talking about it now? Why is it coming out now? Why isn't it resonating? Why isn't it being squashed? Why is Neil deGrasse Tyson addressing this on primetime television? Why is a Grammy-nominated rapper making a song about it? Why is it getting so many hits? Why is it being recommended? I mean, if you want to suppress this thing, all you have to do is go into YouTube, change a couple lines of code, and say, don't recommend this topic to anybody. And I get calls all the time. It's like, oh, yeah, it was recommended to me, and I was just looking up cat videos. Like, why is this thing resonating? And it's because it feels like here we are moving into what I call Act 3, where you make the big move, and the big moves are the ones where you can try to brace against it all you want, but the general population, you know full well, you know, the first alien ship that lands, as long as they don't look like they're green or red or something weird, people are going to buy into it. They're going, yeah, we're totally under this. Show us some signs and wonders. Wow, they turned the moon purple. That's really cool. That's all it would take. And, you know, the mainstream media could propagate the story and ta-da, there you go.
Well, and this kind of ties into what Rob Skiba, Tom Horn, Steve Quayle talk about is the Nephilim. They believe this last